These marvelous artifacts bear many names. The people of Gildenland call them Kryploths. In the lands of the Tumalades, they're known as Al-Satafari, the Eyes of the Night. Most Aventurians, however, know these mysterious orbs as Dark Eyes. The gods themselves are said to have thrown these objects from their heavenly fortress, Alvaron, into the face of Dare to aid the greatest heroes in their most desperate times and allow them to glimpse far distant places in Aventuria and other worlds. Some of them are rumored to look into long-gone pasts, others show the future, and some of them are even cursed, showing pictures that shred the minds of the careless. Only a select few people, chosen by destiny, ever came into possession of a dark eye, and more than once an orb became more of a burden than a helpful tool. Encyclopedia Magica, Garethian Edition, 1001 After the Fall of Bosparan. Hello there, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Mildra, and I will be your gaming monk for the evening. Ever since I started this series, I've always been fascinated by the role-playing scene of countries outside of my own. Now those of you who have listened to the interviews I've done over the past few months, you might have seen this pattern, but I like observing the development of the subculture that is role-playing within other sets of circumstances. Typically, these places will have games that establish a foothold there more than other parts of the world. Middle-earth role-playing, for example, is a game I keep hearing about from the UK. Sword World has a decent foothold in Japan, and so on. This week, we'll be delving into the land of cheese and power metal, Germany, for the game that's referred to as the country's most popular role-playing game, known as Das Schwarze Auge. Wow, that's real bad German. Or The Dark Eye. This is the brainchild of Dromer Naur and Schmidt Spiele, and from what I've been told, is considered the definitive fantasy RPG in Germany. But how does its 5th edition hold up when it enters the hallowed halls of my temple? Let's find out. At 418 pages, The Dark Eye is a fairly dense book that has a presentation style that's reminiscent of Dungeons & Dragons 3rd edition. By that, I mean it uses the old paper-like background art and corner art feel that D&D 3rd edition does. Fortunately, the individual pages make sure not to come off too samey, and the art direction is very good throughout, though I do wish there was more environmental art. It's funny that The Dark Eye is referred to as a German D&D, because to me this falls into a similar trap of having a non-setting setting, at least in the core book that I have. It's not as bad as in D&D's case, but it's still there. Character creation is a freeform affair, and thus there's a lot of room for variation in its multi-step approach. I'll be exploring this with a mercenary named Ariel Iceflight. Now, the first step is the level of experience, which determines the adventure points, this game's version of experience, available to spend, as well as the caps within spending said adventure points. Since we'll be going with experience, we have 1100 adventure points, with an attribute maximum of 14, attribute total of 100, skill maximum of 10, combat skill maximum of 12, spell total of 12, and 2 other traditions, at most. Second step is race, which provides the base modifiers for life points, spirit, toughness, movement, attribute maximums, as well as advantages, disadvantages, and AP costs, if any. We'll be going with half-elf, allowing us to have one higher maximum to a signal attribute, in this case, strength. The other modifiers we'll deal with when we get to derived stats. Step 4 is culture, where the hero hails from. This determines the character's language, area knowledge, social standing, starting skills, and AP cost for the package. This costs us 55 AP and grants us its appropriate skill ratings as a start. In our case, the culture we went with is the Fern Elf, or Snow Elves. Step 5 is attributes. Now, there are 8 attributes to distribute points, and bear in mind the attribute values cannot exceed more than 100. As well as the fact that no attribute can be higher than 14, with the exception of strength at 15. We'll be putting it in the following spread. Courage 12, Sagacity 12, Intelligence 11, Charisma 11, Dexterity 12, Agility 13, Constitution 14, and Strength 15, which costs us a total of 555 AP. Step 6 is profession. Now, professions dictate your pre-hero background, who you studied or learned from, unless you were self-taught, and similar matters. A profession is a starting package that grants skill points, combat skills, abilities, and, if appropriate, spells, cantrips, liturgical chants, and blessings, depending on what your build is. Of course, it's important to note how a profession still requires AP spending, as with the other steps in the process. I'll be going with the Knight profession, which might seem odd for a Fern Elf, but I see it as storytelling potential. This costs us 230 AP and grants us its appropriate skills and special abilities. Step 7 is Advantages and Disadvantages, and this is the most point-buy-esque of the steps. And of course, disadvantages add AP to spend. There's a lot of options present, but fortunately the book provides suggested examples in both your choice of culture and in profession. The book does recommend a range of 80 AP as a budget for this step. We'll be taking Incompetent in Mechanics, Personality Flaw, Principles Level 2, Susceptible to Heat as disadvantages, and Ambidextrous, Increased Life Points Level 3, Increased Toughness, and Rugged Fighter as our advantages. Step 8 is Improving Abilities. Here we can spend the remaining AP to improve attributes, skills, combat skills, spells, and chants. Cost to improve these is based on a letter grade system, since some skills cost less than others. For example, a D skill costs 4 AP per skill in the 1-12 range, whereas an A skill costs 1 AP per skill level, again in the 1-12 range. This is in addition to the buy-in cost to activate a skill. Step 9 concerns combat skill values. It's important to note that all combat skills are rated at 6 before applying AP. This is also where the attack, parry, and range combat base values are determined, with attack being modified by courage, range combat by dexterity, parry by the primary attribute of the given combat skill. Step 10 is special abilities. The combat and non-combat abilities where we spend the remaining AP in. In other games, these may be considered akin to feats or knacks. These are split between general, combat, magic, and miracles-based special abilities. Step 11 is equipment, and every character starts with a budget of 750 silver thalers. And there's a few equipment packages we can go into if need be. We'll take one of these in the travel package, as well as a bastard sword, leather armor, and a spear, which leaves us with 115 silver thalers. Finally, we have the derived attributes based on attributes and special abilities. This grants us a life point maximum of 36, a spirit of 3, a toughness of 2, a dodge of 7, movement of 8, initiative of 13, and 3 fate points. The fact that it uses a point-based approach is a double-edged sword, which is why some of the steps I glossed over the individual pieces, because otherwise this thing would have been a lot longer than it normally would. On one hand, it allows for great deals of flexibility, but it can result in choice overload. This is why I keep insisting that point-buy approaches don't need sample characters as much as they need sample archetypes. The Dark Eye does this to an extent with its cultural and profession packages, but I'm not entirely sure if that's enough. As much as I like the way it's structured, it does have the point-spending problem to a degree, even if it's lesser than other games that I've covered. But putting aside the point-buy problem, the game definitely has a guided flexibility to make it as unscary as it possibly can, but I do not care for special abilities being split between chapters the way that it is in the book. It's really good, but there's a few notches in the proverbial armor. The Dark Eye uses a roll-under d20 system, similar to Dungeon Slayers, also from Germany, funny that. When making a check, you roll a d20 and compare it to a given attribute of a similar value. Natural 1s are critical successes, and natural 20s are botches after a confirmation roll. Now with skill rolls, you instead roll 3 d20s and compare them to 3 different attributes to determine your degree of success. Where skills factor into this is skill points, a resource you can spend to edit the results on a 1-to-1 basis, but this has a double-edged sword. The remaining skill points after a check will determine the quality level of that skill check. This means that one has to determine whether landing the action or doing it better is more important. The system also applies to spells and miracles, but we'll get to that later. Fate points are the Dark Eye's version of extra effort, and each character has 3 at the start. These can be used to act first in combat for a round, boost defense, increase the quality level of a check, or even perform a reroll. In addition, special abilities can offer avenues to fate use. As evidenced by the combat skills we talked about in character creation, combat is very, well, skill-based. but are not rolled with three die like normal skills. The attacker first attempts to roll under their attack or ranged combat. If the roll is successful, the target may attempt a parry or dodge roll in a similar manner, noting that each defense after the first suffers a cumulative -3 penalty. If the attempt fails, the attacker rolls damage and subtract the target's protection from the result. In an interesting spin, the reach of weapons plays a kind of rock-paper-scissors approach, where the reach of the attacker and defender might have an attack penalty on the, well, attacker. For example, if a character with a short-reach weapon like a dagger is attacking someone with a long-reach weapon like a halberd, he suffers a -4 penalty to his attacks. The only issue I have combat-wise is the fact that shields are relegated to defense-centric items. I prefer the option of using shield bashing and similar techniques with the shields as opposed to just having them be a defense boost. I do like the roll under system here, especially the way it works for skills. The only thing that throws me off about the core system is the divorcing, for lack of a better word. Now, I've admitted my preference for a unified setup with die rolling in the past, and while this doesn't have as much of a problem as it does in other games, it is something I can't help but notice since I like the flexibility of this 3d20 approach, with skills discouraging dump statting. But I'd be remiss if I didn't address the supernatural aspect of the game. So let's do that, covering spellcasting first. As I mentioned before, magic in the Dark Eye is a skill-based affair. Thus, it uses the 3d20 approach that mundane skills utilize. While the three attributes may change from spell to spell, there's an option to have a set trinity based on the spell's property. Most spells that aren't cantrips require expending arcane energy to cast, as well as a casting time and specific material prerequisites. It should be noted that because spells are effectively skills, they are improved in the same way you would improve skills. In addition, there are no spell levels. The improvement letter cost is the replacement of this. And a further potential restriction is the tradition of the caster, which can determine the potential spool of spells that they can use effectively, as well as requirements for casting. This, along with spell modifications, mean that spells are not the fire-and-forget affairs of his contemporaries. But since we've covered one half of the supernatural, we should cover the other half with miracles. The powers of the Blessed Ones are channeled through blessings and liturgical chants, the divine twin to magic's cantrips and spells. Similarly, individual chants act as skills unto themselves, but require the expenditure of karma points instead of arcane energy. Now, one wrinkle thrown into the mix is that spending large amounts of karma points inflicts a condition called Rapture, inflicting 1 degree on every 10 points spent. Rapture inflicts a gradual penalty to skill and spell checks that aren't agreeable to the caster's god, but a bonus to those that are. This means that your tradition, or the deity you serve, as its equivalent, is significantly important. Unfortunately, there's not really an equivalent to the optional property rule that there is for mages, which I think could have been useful here. For the longest time, I was told that the Dark Eye was German D&D. Personally, I don't quite see it that way, but I will admit a degree of ignorance on my part since I'm only familiar with 4th and 5th edition Dark Eye. So I have less of a grasp on how the game may have evolved over the years. But from my perspective, it has more in common with Warhammer Fantasy roleplay than D&D, but with the range of careers, semi-freeform advancement, and less of the wargame-centric classes and defined paths. Doubly so since the damage system doesn't like to use anything more than d6s, akin to Warhammer using d5s and d10s. There is still one part of D&D's DNA that persists here, though, and that's the segmented mechanics. As I said before, I like the degrees of success approach that can come with the use of three attributes, especially since it can potentially add a degree of unpredictability to the challenges. The 1d20 approach for things like combat isn't bad, but a little unification never hurt. Beyond that, the freeform nature of character possibilities will doubtless be a situation where you love the freedom it brings or you find the sheer choices overwhelming. Now, another artifact from D&D that I mentioned earlier is that the core book is more akin to a player's handbook than anything else. This is understandable given the amount of potential choices the game has, but it means there's going to be less attention to the aventurious setting. This can lead to that half-in, half-out issue that happens with D&D's attempts to have a setting without the, setting. I'll dive into this in a future musing because it's outside the realm of this particular video, but even with all that, I'm willing to give the game a stamp of strongly recommended, with the added asterisk of getting the Aventuria Almanac alongside the core book if you can. Otherwise, this would just be recommended. This is a very flexible game, and definitely for those who like hacking their works into a form that they use, even including a checklist for the amount of optional rules in the book. That's not something you see often. I do think that having the setting to accompany it makes for a stronger foundation, but even without it, there's a lot that the Dark Eye has to offer. Suffice to say, I can see why the game has the position it does in the German role-playing scene. In many ways, I even prefer it to the alleged world's greatest role-playing game.
If you would like to support Mildra the Monk and his endeavors, be sure to subscribe to his YouTube channel. Follow him on Twitter.com and possibly support him on Patreon. We shall see you again, my fine adventurers.